Gentlemen on the dais, ladies and gentlemen, I have a small quarrel with the compere because she called me as a grand old man. He should have stopped saying grand man. I don't know why she has added old. While Mr. Anupam Kher was talking here, he said he doesn't believe in writing this speech because he is an actor. Actors are always like politicians. They are always extempore. They can afford to be extempore. But poor man, I am a director. I am responsible to the society. Every word that counts comes from, if it comes from me, I'll have to take particular, very particular care of what I choose. So I always come prepared with a text whenever I am asked to address a gathering. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. A tragedy translated into a tribute for triumph in cinema. This is what this day symbolizes to me. I recollect vividly having stood for the same cause, paying the same respects, on addressing almost the same gathering with the same purpose, resolution, conviction, along with sympathy and grief in our eyes and minds for the first edition of this homage, for want of a more appropriate word. Ladies and gentlemen, I feel pious, almost holy, standing here. I feel sanctity in the sacredness of this occasion. I distinctly remember speaking my heart out on that day, so many years ago, exactly, to be exact, it is more than 10 years. I distinctly remember expressing my empathy to the bereaved family, as well as even confessing to an unknown sense of guilt. Empathy because I understood the grief and the sadness of the family for losing a person so young and promising. The guilt because I felt that in some way I was backhanded cause for the tragic accident of Gollapudi Srinivas, because it was the very same spot in those virgin wild beaches of Vizag that I had shot my more famous films like Maro Charitra, Ek Dujay Ke Liye, Sindhu Bhairavi, etc., braving the onslaught of the fiery waves. I felt guilt because I thought maybe it was the addiction to these locations that hastened and caused this man's ominous, tragic, unfortunate end. Ladies and gentlemen, I bowed my head in prayer for that lost soul then. My head and heart continue to be bowed till this day. I also distinctly remember wishing that the beginning that was made that day would continue long after the sadness and the grief have dimmed, for time is a great healer. And I can't help being simply astonished at not only the committed continuity that this award has achieved, but also the sanctity, the aura, and the prestige behind this award that has increased in leaps and bounds across the past years. And this Gollapudi Srinivas Memorial Award, which was born from sentiment, has become a most sought after one. At this stage, I cannot help recollect the comments of my good friend Kamal Haasan when somebody questioned him recently about winning the Oscar. Kamal is supposed to have remarked in his uniquely cerebral way, "Let us not aspire for Hollywood recognition. Instead, let us try to make better cinema and make Hollywood aspire for Indian recognition." Maybe Mr. Kamal Haasan was referring to the Gollapudi Srinivas Award. And I, for one, am fully convinced that every single film that has received this recognition across the past years has been of truly inspirational and international standards. Maybe someday soon there will be a Gulappudi Srinivas Award for best films made outside India, and I am convinced that it will be as prestigious as the Oscar claims to be. I am sure, with the conviction, commitment, passion and dedication of the family of Gulappudi Srinivas who are behind this movement, that day is neither impossible nor too far away. Hats off to all of you who have safeguarded the integrity of this award and made it what it is today. And just to think that there are filmmakers who have been received, recognized and rewarded for only their first film, and thus have found the motivation and the incentive to make cinema their vocation, is indeed extremely encouraging and at the same time immensely satisfying. God bless the memory and the family of Gulappudi Srinivas. Tare Zameen Par, the stars have come down to earth. Mother India, Dobiga Zameen, Pyasa, Duaon Ke Barahat, Shri 420, Chandralekha were some of the films I grew up with, were the cinemas that taught me to expand my emotions and expand my ambitions. These are the films, along with a host of others, in a host of languages, from a host of geographies, that made me want, ache, crave, and die to be a filmmaker. These are the films that taught me that camera is larger than the pen, that the moving picture can move faith, even as it crosses boundaries, transcends tongues, conquers and subdues narrow domestic walls, both in the mind and in the society. This is the cinema that I try to make, sometimes failed, sometimes succeeded, and yet somehow in the process managed to make it as much of my life as also a means of living. I made 100 films, and as age caught up with me, and even though my spirit was willing, I took refuge in the universal cowardly excuse of all 60 past filmmakers that the quality of cinema has deteriorated, the content of cinema has degenerated, and the audience's taste have become so puerile that they do not deserve the services of a self-centered, arrogant filmmakers like them, me included. I took refuge in such excuses. I hid behind the fiction of box office. I cowed down against extravagance. I shivered under celluloidal indulgence. I shunned patronizing stars and decided physically, mentally and in public that it is not possible to make good cinema anymore, that pure cinema is getting destroyed by the onslaught of larger than life suspended disbelief. I almost gave up. I lived in the ivory tower of my past achievements, rested on the laurels of memory, and in general convinced myself that I was the monarch of all that I once ruled. Ladies and gentlemen, I stand corrected. I was wrong. I plead guilty. Because Tare Zameen Par happened. Until this man called Amir Khan destroyed and shattered my complex and peace of mind. Ladies and gentlemen, I hate this man, Amir Khan. He has provoked me to clean the cobwebs of my brain and inspired me to look at scripts again. Ladies and gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, I stand corrected. I adore this man, Amir Khan. For he made me cry and yet somehow left me happy. I think the only other match that India won after the World Cup in 1983 was in Lagan. That film was a shot in the arm for not only Indian cinema, but also Indian cricket. After seeing Rang Di Basanti, everybody went out to buy the Indian national flag. After seeing Tare Zameen Par, a society has become more aware of its shortcomings. A generation has been given a torch to hold and go forward. Lagan proved that this was not a chocolate boy, but a boy with a purpose, with Rangde Basanti, he proved to be a man with a mission. With Tare Zameen Par, Amir Khan is a man with a destiny, for he is also its creator. I adore this man, Amir Khan, for he made me cry and yet made me happy. To quote Charlie Chaplin, life laughs at you when you are unhappy. Life smiles at you when you are happy. But life salutes you when you make others happy. I salute Mr. Amir Khan. I salute. I have never been moved by a moving picture as I have been by Tare Zameen Par across the past 50 years of my professional career. Or perhaps even the past 75 years of Indian cinema. What insufferable impudence this boy has got, that he strolls into the film only at the end of the first half. It is the confidence he had in his script. What inspired this man to allow a buck-toothed baby to take the lead and steal our hearts? What humility I found when he slipped his name behind the child's in the titles. To be honest, ladies and gentlemen, right from the time he jumbled graphics started playing, when the film opened in every frame, in every shot, in every sequence, in every running foot, in every word, in every line, in every dialogue, in every visual, in every prop, in every single note of sound, I saw nothing else but the hand, the mind, the vision, the dream, the passion, the control of none other than the director Amir Khan. Ladies and gentlemen, when the film was over, it took a little extra time for the audience to clear the aisles. For not only did they have to stand up and applaud, but they also had to compose themselves and wipe their tears before the lights came on. Where is the consciousness of performance that invariably creeps up even in the best of artists? Where were the kabuki mannerisms that are almost unerasable in the most experienced of stars? Where was the camera hidden? Where were the lights? Where were the technicians? How did the director brush off all the doubts and reservations that must have echoed in his ears and his consciousness all across the making of this film without the so-called commercial escapisms? Or was his belief and faith in himself and his craft such that he had no doubts, no reservation, no misgivings at all? I feel ashamed that I, with all my years in cinema, did not have the same faith in my dreams that this man has. I feel chastened that I, with all my wisdom of experience, did not have the same awareness and trust in the intelligence of the audience that this man has. What magic is this that made me hope and even believe that maybe, just maybe, a product of 9 into 3 could somehow be manipulated and made to be 3 as that child did? From which divine source did this filmmaker draw the inspiration, the strength, the belief, and the courage to think of a plot such as this, to build a screenplay around after creating a story and make the film and release it with absolute conviction that it will be a blockbuster? Years ago, when I was just an aspiring filmmaker, I happened to have had the honor of meeting the great legendary S.S. Vasan of Gemini Studios in person. Such was the reputation and genius of this awe-inspiring man. Such was his stature and standing in Indian cinema that I was very reluctant, very diffident, and even a little ashamed to introduce myself as also a filmmaker, lest I be judged against his parameters, lest I be compared against his achievements, lest I be measured against his standards and found wanting. Believe me, ladies and gentlemen, it was with the same diffidence, the same nervousness, and the same sense of inadequacy and awe I felt when I picked up the phone to talk to this awesome filmmaker, Amir Khan. I have just seen this film. I immediately wanted to know his telephone number. I somehow or other, I got it with a very great difficulty. His mobile was ringing. I was nervous. How to open up the conversation when he comes on the line? I was nonplussed. What is the first word I have to say? Is it hello or namaste or what else? Should I call him by his name or have I to say sir? That was a terrific dilemma. When he said yes on the mobile, nervously I said, I am a small time filmmaker from Chennai by name Balchandra. Was it modesty or honesty, whatever it is, I said with a bashful restraint. Immediately he said, no sir, I'm a fan of yours, he said. That gave me all the courage for me, and I spoke about this film which was making waves all over India, all over the globe. He said, I shall try to meet you when I come to Chennai. And as luck would have it, the opportunity came through the Golapudi family, and I have the sweet privilege of giving away this award to him in person. It has taken Aamir Khan to not just wake up Indian cinema from its complacency, but also make it realize its shortcomings and extravagances as well as its potential and possibilities. Because Aamir Khan has made cinema from where it always should be made, from the heart. There is no better person who deserves the Golapudi Srinivas Award than Mr. Aamir Khan for his classic Tare Zameen Par. And I am honored, humbled, privileged, and blessed in joining you all in giving this man a standing ovation. Thank you, thank you. So, like the starkness of Ritvik Ghatak, the celluloidal sagacity of a Satyajit Ray, the grandeur of a Mehboob Khan, the poignancy of a Shantaram, the sensuality of a Raj Kapoor, the simplicity of a Basu Chatterjee, the poetic indulgence of Gulzar, the melodrama of Mrinal Sen, the profundity of a Gurudutt, the imagination of a Kamal Amrohi, the pragmatism of Hrishikesh Mukherjee, the showmanship of S.S. Vasan, the versatility of a L.V. Prasad, the sincerity of a Sridhar, the magic of a Maniratnam. To this eloquent list, to this selected catalogue in this celebrated directory, to this exclusive club will now be added the intensity and the integrity of Mr. Aamir Khan. Ladies and gentlemen, Aamir Khan is cinema's own Sachin Tendulkar. He has a triple century on debut. Mr. Aamir Khan is our own MS Dhoni. Indian cinema is now led by safer hands. Mr. Aamir Khan is the new Don, D-A-W-N, Don of Indian cinema. Ladies and gentlemen, the new Don, D-O-N. The cricketing pun is specifically and intentionally intended, Don Bradman of Indian cinema. Why go to history? Mr. Aamir Khan has hit the bullseye and made gold. Yes, is now the AB of Indian cinema. I mean Abhinav Bindra. Abhinav Bindra, who is the toast of India today, I congratulate him once again. have no other words to congratulate him because I was so much obsessed with the film when I saw it. I thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for giving me this opportunity to talk to you. I take this opportunity of telling here and expressing my happiness over being present for a live performance by Jagjit Singh Babu. Because I have been a very earnest fan of ghazals, not knowing even a single word. I have been a ghazal listener and a ghazal fan. I thank you, sir, for the beautiful program you have given today. I thank Golappudi family for a very sophisticated way of making out a very, very nostalgic, beautiful evening. Thank you.